Now we will start the self and peer assessment. Can anybody say that what is the self and peer self assessment or peer assessment? What is your understanding about this? Sriman Manish Gautam. But when we see the genesis of self and peer assessment, how this self and peer assessment emerged as a modality of assessment in the teaching learning process. In the very beginning, I was discussing, and you might be able to remember, that when we think of teaching and learning, the assessment is the inbuilt process. We cannot separate the assessment from the teaching learning process. It is the inbuilt in the teaching learning process. First thing. Second thing, that when we talk about the assessment on the practice basis, there are two categories of assessment. One category is the conventional method of assessment. That is the paper pencil test, that is even sometime the oral testing, sometime the written testing, okay, like that. These are the conventional methods of testing and evaluation. However, these conventional method of assessment and evaluation, so I will request that you can mute your microphone so that the unnecessary voice will not disturb each other. Please check that your microphone is muted. Sarita, your microphone is not muted. Please mute it.
Oh, yes, sir.
So, those assessment techniques lacks in some area and they are not effective from some point of view. However, when we talk about the effectiveness and usefulness, no assessment technique or no even teaching learning technique is you can say that the very much good in all respect. Every technique have its own merit. However, every technique as well, there lacks in some areas. When we talk about the conventional methods of assessment, the authenticity of the assessment is always in question. One thing. Because in the testing process, in the assessment process, in the evaluation process, you cannot cover all the things. And even the scope of feedback, it is very much limited. Sometimes the student may not understand that what kind of a difficulty they are facing. And a student may also feel a shyness, they may be shy, and they may not express in front of the teachers, and that will hinder in the teaching learning process. So what we are doing the giving opportunity to the learner themselves and giving opportunity to the peer member of the learner to assess their performance. And that's why when we talk about the self-assessment, it occurs when the student assess and make judgment about themselves of their own work. Here the teacher will be not assessing, here the learner itself will be assessing and making a judgment about their own work. Because in the learning journey, learner has to evolve a process in which they can learn in a better manner. The teacher will be supporting, of course. Teacher will be also identifying that how the learner can learn better. But the learner will be in a better position to identify how, when, and which, by which method they can learn better. Because when we talk about the assessment and evaluation, one of the objective is to grade, but another objective, which is very important, is to identify the learner's strength and the area where we can help also. Both the things. Teacher is also doing by deploying several assessment and evaluation method to identify their strength and the area where they need support. But all the things may not be possible to identify by the teacher. It can be identified by the learner in a better manner. And that's why in the self-assessment process, a student is assessing and making assessment about their own work. That how they have did a work, what kind of a challenges they were facing, and what kind of a opportunity they had, what kind of a strength they had during the learning process. Similarly, when we talk about the peer assessment. Peer assessment is an arrangement when a student make assessment decision on other student work. Because sometime when the teacher will comment on the student work, it may not be very comfortable position for the student. Or sometime student may be feeling shyness to express their difficulty in front of others. You just remember your school time. Because to understand all these things, your own experience during a school or during a learning process is a very rich resource. Some of the time, we were not asking the teacher about the difficulty that we are facing in the learning. Why? Because we are thinking that if I will ask, what the teacher will think. That this is a very simple thing and you don't know. The teacher, we have that kind of a feeling, and every student have this kind of a feeling. This is very natural. It is not something which is very extraordinary. It is a very natural that we used to think that if I will ask this very common, very easy thing, what the teacher will think. And that's why we are not asking. We prefer to ask to a peer member, to our friend with whom we are very familiar. Even we are not asking to other peer members with whom we are not very much familiar, with whom we are not having a very good friendship. To whom we are asking? With we are very much comfortable. So peer assessment is a process to provide them a comfortable zone to express their difficulty, so that these can be addressed on time to help the teacher. This is the important thing. Now comes that, is there single benefit of using self and peer assessment like that to provide a comfortable zone to express their difficulty? Is this is the only single point, isn't it? No. When we talk about the self and peer assessment, actually it is reflective in nature. Reflective in nature means here the main purpose of assessment and evaluation is not to grade the student, rather than it is a process to understand their difficulty. It may be by themselves, if it is a case of a self-assessment, or with the help of peer members, if it is a peer assessment. So when we talk about the self and peer assessment, it is a reflective in nature. And the second thing is that it also motivates the learner to learn. Intrinsic motivation and extrinsic motivation, both comes in between when we talk about the self and a peer assessment. How it motivates? First, we will try to understand. Because it gives them opportunity to express their difficulty and to clarify, to get assistance on time. If it is not coming on time, then the student will be demotivated because they will be feeling difficulty in the learning process. But if it will be addressed on time, they will be motivated to learn because they will think that the things are easy. And if they will start thinking that the things are easy, I have friends, those who can help me on time, then it will be motivation within the self of a student. That is the intrinsic motivation. No one will be motivating them, but as and when they will be getting success, as and when they will be able to clarify all the doubts, and as and when they will be able to understand that the contents are not very tough because the assistance is provided on time. So it will lead to an intrinsic motivation. And it will also provide an opportunity of extrinsic motivation if it is a case of peer assessment. Because when you have a doubt, you can ask your peer, and with the peer member, they will be comfortable too. And the peer member can say that these things you can study, this thing you can work, this thing you can solve in this manner. So actually the source of motivation is outside the person by someone. That is the extrinsic motivation. So it will be motivating also. The next benefit is that here a student have the ownership of their own learning. They will be identifying, they will be designing the way in which they can minimize those difficulty, and then again they will be studying. So it will be a kind of a cyclic process where the ownership of a learning will be with a student. They will have a ownership of a learning. Then another thing is that when we talk about the self and peer assessment, here the self and peer assessment develops the learner ability to self-evaluate and reflect. How the self, because one thing you must understand, evaluating your own work and getting feedback from your own work and then designing the modality to overcome those difficulties is a skill. It is not like that all of us can identify where we are facing problem and how to overcome that problem for solving problem. Here the problem is that how to learn better. It is a skill which develops over the time by practicing. And when we will give a opportunity to the student for self assessment and a peer assessment, they will have a ownership of that and they will develop the skill of identifying their difficulty and how to cope up with those difficulty in order to get a success. So in that way also the self assessment and peer assessment works. Then when we talk about the self and peer assessment, it also provides the opportunity of a consistent feedback. Because just think of the other assessment modalities that will be done by the teachers. Other assessment like a paper pencil test, like a oral testing, or like a portfolio, or whatever the method, even the interview, focused group discussion, other assessment. So it will not giving a consistent feedback. Consistent feedback means the teacher will assess and evaluate, and then they will give a feedback, then you will work, and then the teacher will assess, and then you will be given a feedback. So it will be not a continuous process. It will be a process at a regular interval of a time, which may not be very much useful as the self and peer assessment is useful. Why? Because in the self and peer assessment, we are getting a continuous feedback. We are doing, we are understanding, and again we are doing, again we are understanding. So in other way, you can also understand that self and a peer assessment works on the principle of trial and error. We work, we are getting difficulty, we think how we can overcome out of that. Again, we are working, again, we are getting feedback. So the feedback and a reflection is the inbuilt mechanism of the self and peer assessment, as previously also I was talking about this, which is coming continuously with the work, with the process. Here, they are not supposed to wait for the process. Waiting is not required. It is a continuous. It is inbuilt, which is the added advantage in the assessment process. The another benefit is that self and peer assessment is also potential from the point of view saving the time, because I was saying that when we will be dependent upon the assessment by teacher, it will take time, because the teacher will be planning for assessment, they will assess, they will get the feedback, and then they will try to communicate the student and they will work on that. So it will be not a continuous, rather than it will be at a regular frequency. Rather than the self and peer assessment is not at a regular interval. It is continuous. So here you are not supposed to wait for the process to over and then you will get a feedback. No, here you can get a feedback and reflection throughout the process of teaching and learning. So in that manner, it is a time saving also. And moreover, when we talk about the self and peer assessment, it is based upon the student's own experiences, on reflection, and on understanding about their teaching learning process. So that will be more authentic, more fruitful, because it's not other opinion upon your work, rather than it's your reflection on your work that will be very much authentic than the other one. So that's why we try to provide a opportunity for self and peer assessment. But now the question comes that how we can do a self and peer assessment. That is the one of the question. How we can plan for the self and peer assessment. Can anybody say that if you have to do a self and peer assessment, what kind of a modality you will be using for self and peer assessment? How you will do? Can anybody say? Jyoti Ranjan, are you here? Jyoti?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Huh. How you will do?
Sir, I'll try.
How you will try? Can you say? Okay. So, for implementing self and peer assessment, one thing you remember that it is not like that. Sriman is saying something. I will take their response. First, we have to set the area of assessment. Yes, what you want to assess, that you have to set out. Very much correct. I have thought of explaining it myself because the time is only left 10 minutes. So I thought of completing this in this class. But okay, I can take one, two more responses. Santosh ji, are you here?
Hello.
Haan, Biswajita, I will take your response after Santosh.
Hello.
Haan, Biswajita, okay. Yes, you tell me.
Biswajita.
Making observation schedule. So Basri is saying. Santosh ji, are you here? Santosh Beura?
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. How you will do self and peer assessment in the classroom?
Sir, by taking their opinion, sir.
By taking their opinion. So you will
answer.
Directly ask them that what is your opinion? Just tell me. Like that?
Yes. Yes, sir. After ending the session, sir, we will take their feedback or opinion or statement regarding, okay, that means for improvement of the topic, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other?
Sir,
one?
Jo,
Biswajita.
Yes, sir. Self-assessment ke liye hum log use karte hain wo checklist, rating scale, questionnaire.
You are correct, but little bit refinement is required. That refinement I will do now. Okay, so one thing you remember that when we are planning for self and peer assessment, so don't think that we will tell them that you have to do a self assessment or a peer assessment and the student will do and they will identify. No, it will not happen. Why it will not happen? Because some of the time they may be able to identify their difficulties and their strength also. But we cannot expect that all the time they will be able to identify. Because they are a student, they are learner, they are exploring, they are learning. So we cannot expect. And if they are able to do, then it's well and good. Your purpose will be served. But if they are not able to do, then it will be difficulty. That's why throughout the process, it is not like that you have to sit and observe. No, continuously you have to work and you have to plan for that. For self and peer assessment, first we will see that the peer assessment. Because in the peer assessment process, peer is supposed to assess the each other's performance. So first thing is that they must be provided opportunity to work in a group, work in a peer group. Unless or until they won't be provided opportunity to work in a group, then how the peer member will be observing? It is not like that they will go to the students, other peer members whom and they will observe. No. You have to provide the opportunity. And how the opportunity will be provided? By planning for a group work, projects, collaborative learning, cooperative learning, so that they can work in a group. And then you have to make a clear and accurate rubrics. In the rubrics, I was talking that a rubrics is the criteria-based performance assessment. That is the rubric. So you have to, I will show one rubric. You have to use a clear and accurate rubric related to the work they are doing, so that peer can see that what was supposed and what and where the student is actually, so that they can assess and they can give a constructive feedback for improvement. And in the self-assessment also, when we talk about the self-assessment, in the self-assessment process, a student must be provided the opportunity to reflect on their own work. And the one of the modality may be the structured reflective diary, which may include how they are learning, what kind of a difficulty they are facing, what are the way to come out of the difficulty, isn't it? So for the self-assessment, a structured reflective diary may be one of the useful tool. However, for the peer assessment, a clear and accurately defined rubric can be helpful. I will show you one rubric. Just wait 1 minute. I think window is visible to you. Are you getting the window?
Yes, sir.
Yes, so sir. This is the example of peer and self-assessment for novice and experienced student. This is the actually the rubric. See, there are three labels in this rubric: novice, intermediate, and the expert. Three labels are there. And here, when we are doing a peer assessment, the other student will see their performance. That student writes, identify the different aspect, because this is a three aspect it is written, because it is developed on the some other topic, but the different aspect of the completed work in general you can understand. Or you can make a very customized rubric as per your need, how the rubric can be made and how the rubrics are made. I think you must be knowing. Otherwise, if you are not knowing, then there is a some content in the last bit of this paper, this unit. There I will discuss in detail about that, what are the different components of a rubric and how it is made. So suppose that the student is able to identify the different aspect. The student provides the feedback on the different aspect where the peer needs to improve. They are able to provide a feedback if some student is not able to do. And the academic provides a formative feedback, picking up on the theme. So if they are able to do this much only, then they are a novice. Then if the student will move afterwards, then it will be intermediate. If students are able to do beyond that, then we can term them as a expert. So by that, we can make a rubric. Rubric is a performance-based assessment criteria. We are setting a performance. And based upon that, we are trying to know their label of expertise, and based upon that we are giving a feedback. Okay, so that was all about that self and peer assessment. Now it is a time for question answer session. We will have a very small question answer session, then we will end this class. So if you have any kind of a doubt or a question, you can ask me now. You can ask in the chat box, as well as you can use the voice chat. You can speak here also, or you can write in the chat box. Any question?
No, sir.
Okay. So, shall we stop this session here?
Okay, sir.
Okay, so thank you for being with me in this class. Have a nice time.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.